This is TWiT.
Speaking of photos, it's time for our photo guy, Chris Marquardt. He's my personal photo sensei at sensei.photo, S-E-N-S-E-I.photo. That's where he does coaching and classes. He's also going to do workshops. And I got some good news from my wife. She says, as soon as we can go on a Chris Marquardt photo workshop, we're going. As soon as I want to go to Bhutan, he goes all over the world. I don't think she wants Svalbard, the one where you go in the ice boat up to the North Pole. That sounds chilly.
It's not that bad.
Anyway.
It's fun.
Find out more at sensei.photo. Of course, Tips from the Top Floor. His podcast is legend amongst photographers. And he joins us each week to inspire us. What are you inspiring us with this week, Chris?
Well, I thought we could talk about the one thing that photography is all about and that we've talked about a million times before, but maybe not from this angle, and that is light. Light in general is what photography is about. And light itself, I mean, it has a direction, it has a size, it has a color, it has all different properties. But the one thing that you often don't really get to see is the light itself. And, you know, there's a light source, yes. There's something that gets hit by the light, so you see that. But the light itself, isn't that visible unless you make it visible? And what I'm talking about is called volumetric light.
Volumetric light, okay.
When light has volume, and there's different ways to get that. And let me just show a few photos here.
Ooh, this is pretty.
This is a picture of a chess piece. It's been lit by a beam of light, and you can see the beam of light, not just the light on the chess piece. And of course, that's what you do when you put something in the air that gets lit up. In this case, smoke, little particles, and those particles get lit up by the light as it crosses through the room, and then you get to see the light itself. And smoke, mist. Mist is a great one.
Ooh,
if it's misty outside and the sun is out, then you end up with sunbeams. And
so the volume in this case is the sunbeams, is the light getting caught by the mist, and it actually makes the light have volume, have
by
size.
The tiny little particles in the mist, the little water particles in mist. They give the light shape, volume, color, all that stuff that you usually only see the end result normally by the light hitting a tree or something. But in this case, on the way to the tree, it hits all these little particles and lights them up. So
nice.
Mist, fog. Again, if you see mist out and sun, beautiful. I love this in nature when you have the sun grazing the side of a mountain and you end up with these, almost like these I call them God rays when it comes mm-hmm, to the clouds, and you have mist in the air, and then you end up with these with the light shining from up above. Works well in the dark as well. So at night, when you have light sources, here is a beautiful picture of a gas station
a beautiful picture of a gas station. Who would have thought?
Yes, this is a super tidy picture, right? There's nothing on it apart from the roof and the car under it and light shining down on the car, but not just the light is shining down. You can see around the light sources, you get this bloom of light, right? It fills the air and it gives it shape. Here's an example of a person walking at night with light coming from streetlights. And the reason I like this a lot is, well, first of all, again, you have volume in the light. And the second thing is that person is right in between two streetlights. So the person is in the dark, and that creates this beautiful silhouette and gives you that feeling of loneliness, right? Doesn't really...
It's a
moody
light.
Night picture.
Yeah.
If you end up with like very strong light sources and very strong fog, this is a person walking on some sort of a bridge or a pier or something. Then you end up with even stronger, in this case, balls of light, and they are not just are they there, they also carry the color of the light, and this is probably some yellowish light sources, and so the light balls are yellowish. if you look in science, like in a laboratory with lasers, they usually have a fog machine. So that makes the laser beams visible. Of course, that works well in entertainment. Laser shows would not be any fun without a foggy air. So that's as soon as you want to make the light visible in an indoor setting where you need some more control, you would use a fog machine. That's what those fog machines are for in stage settings. So musicians on stage, you'll always have fog there because it gives the light volume. So the person who does the light show has something to work with and can show that light. That's accentuated by putting special little things in front of the light that give the light its shape and its beams and things. There's no end in sight. If you work in that field, you know that a fog machine is probably the most essential thing that you would use. Here's another example of light getting a shape, but it's not from any particles in the air. In this case, it's from the lens. If you have a light source that shines straight into the lens, and there are reflections of light in the lens going back and forth between the different layers of glass in the lens. So with depending on the lens that you have, you might end up with the light getting going beyond what you would expect it to. So it blooms out. That's called a lens bloom. If you shoot film, there's film specific film that does that. There's film that's called aura film, which will have light around light sources kind of extending into the dark of the picture. So that's another thing that you can do. And of course, you can move a light source. That gives it volume too. No particles required there. That's a fairground ride that moves with a long exposure, and then you end up with interesting light streaks. And last but not least, you can, of course, just take a light source and move it in front of a camera that has a long exposure going on several seconds and just do light painting. You just paint into the dark and you end up with interesting shapes. So
beautiful.
That's pretty much
beautiful.
Volumetric light in all its different incarnations. I'm a fan of that because it really makes light physical and very touchable. So
if you get up early in the morning, you can get the morning mist. You get some amazing
and
shots.
If the sun comes up, you get nice light streaks in there. Yeah. So
if you never dust in the house, you know, just the light beams, the motes of dust get lit up. It's beautiful.
You can start smoking, you know, that would help.
I'll pick up smoking. All sorts of ways to make it happen. I'll put the link to Chris's gallery of photos in our show notes at techguylabs.com. They're quite beautiful. Chris puts these together for us on Flickr, the photo sharing site. Well, there's another reason we use Flickr. We love Flickr. We have a group there called the Tech Guy Group, and that's where we invite you to submit your entries for our monthly photo assignment. Not a competition. There's no prize. It's just an excuse to get out there and take photos. What's our assignment this month, Chris?
Messy. We're looking for tidy pictures of messy things.
It's a lot easier than tidy was. That was last month's assignment. Messy is easy to find. So take a picture. We're not going to tell you what that means, but take a picture of something that illustrates the concept of the word messy. If you find one you like, upload it to Flickr. Tag it TG Messy, M-E-S-S-Y. Soccer fans may be tempted to put an I at the end. No, it's a Y, M-E-S-S-Y. And you can upload as many as one photo every week. Renee Silverman, our moderator, will accept you. And about 3 weeks from now, Chris will pick three of those photos that best exemplify messy and talk about them on the show. Find Chris Marquardt at sensei.photo and here every week. Thank you, Chris.
Thanks for having me.